Let me introduce our guest. Our keynote today is Danny P. Goel. Dr. Goel is founder of Precision OS. It's a virtual reality experience for surgical simulation. Dr. Goel is an orthopedic surgeon in Vancouver, British Columbia. His passion is evaluating and managing complex shoulder disorders, improving access to care, and educating the current and next generations of surgeons. His software company is focused on immersive, experiential medical education. They use VR and AR to help deliver meaningful education to everyone. So please welcome Dr. Goel. The stage is yours. While you're over to you, Dr. Goel.
Thank you, Yuli. Really appreciate that warm introduction. I'm going to pull up my slides. So a random meeting with Yuli has led to this opportunity to present in front of you all. So I want to really give a special thanks to Yuli after our call a few weeks ago. It's been a wonderful opportunity to meet him and now to be here to share with you some of my thoughts and sort of how I got involved with this company called Precision OS. And I changed the title of my talk, and this is mostly inspired by Sir Ken Robinson. Sir Ken Robinson, for those of you interested in education, really talks about how formal education, he believes, or did believe, killed creativity. So I'll pause there and just move on to my presentation. As Yuli mentioned, I'm a clinical associate professor at UBC, and my disclosure for this presentation and some of the content that you'll see is from the software company that I founded with my co-founders called Precision OS, which is a medical and surgical ed tech solution. Now, I'm going to break this talk into three basic areas. One is really shedding some light on the problem. Number two, talking about the solution that we've come with. And then, of course, sharing the evidence, which we all know is very, very important in healthcare. Now, 500. I put this slide up to showcase this is the number of surgical graduates that graduate every year that are unable to operate independently. And this was done and reported from a large study looking at over 5,000 general surgery residents just in the US. Now, I found this quote by Dr. Halstead because you've seen and heard this, many of you are from healthcare, that the only weapon with which the unconscious patient can immediately retaliate upon the incompetent surgeon is hemorrhage, which I thought was quite telling because we live in an ecosystem where there's a real asymmetry on occasion where what the patient's expectations are and what the physician, and in this case, a surgeon, can deliver. Now, I became interested in this, you know, see one, do one, teach one is really, I believe the phrase is used incorrectly because we use this term and we infer that everybody graduates with this model of learning. But if you go back to reading some of Halstead's original work, he only graduated about 15% of the physicians that practiced under his instruction. And this is actually consistent with the data that I showed you earlier with that number of 500, which is approximately, you know, 30% or just under of the amount of residents that are skilled to operate after practice or after residency. Now, one of the things that certainly I think we all suffer from to some extent is this idea called the Dunning-Kruger effect, which is where confidence, and I'm going to show you an example of this in some of the research we've done, is not always associated with expertise. So always be cognizant of those who are very confident and espouse to be experts, because usually if you go to some of these conferences and listen to experts, there's some uncertainty around the knowledge that they have, not because they don't know, it's because they know a lot about what is actually in this particular space. Now, here's an x-ray of probably one of the most common fractures that we see in orthopedics. This is an x-ray of a hip fracture, and it's fixed with a rod and a screw as shown here. This is an example of the perhaps the most egregious error I've seen by a graduating orthopedic resident. And you can see that nail is in the completely wrong spot. The screw is in the completely wrong spot when you compare it. And you'll be all fearful to know that this trainee, who's now a surgeon, passed a 5-year residency, passed the Royal College exam successfully, did a prestigious fellowship, and then of course in practice was unsuccessful. And of course the patient has suffered. Now, Now, not every complication when you're in practice is that obvious to detect. And here's an example of a resident who is graduating, who tried this software that I'm about to show you and said it's, or the comments were from him is that this is really interesting. It can be helpful in understanding the steps, the procedure prior to an actual case. However, and furthermore, I don't think skill and competence can be assessed. Now, when this trainee went into the module to fix this fracture, as we have in our particular system, you can see that the red line actually indicates where he ended up putting the screw for this hip fracture. Now, you'll be shocked to see that where he should have put the screw is where the green line is. And we know that the position of this screw in this particular case does pose a high risk for fracture. The other thing that we can identify, of course, is that he took 80 x-rays during this particular step. So now we're getting into this idea of quantifying how people behave or identifying how people can behave in a system such as this. Now, one of the things we do as physicians, at least in surgery, is we practice on cadavers. And this is referred to as what I term as practice under the normal. And, you know, this is a famous picture many of you may have seen on the internet. This is a Rembrandt holding the retractor in his right hand is Dr. Tulp. This picture is actually from the Netherlands. Every year he would educate the physicians and care providers in the Netherlands with a single cadaver every year. And the story is such that he would not even do the dissection because he didn't want to get blood on his hands. But you can see there's lots of observation. There's a C1 and there's really no one in this particular painting was the do one. And yet there's going to be a teach many in this environment. Now, if we fast forward to 2020, nearly 400 years later, you can see not much has changed with this model of learning on a cadaver. And there's many people here in this particular lab who are observing what's happening. There's maybe one or two people who are engaged and many others, such as this person smiling into the camera, who's not participating at all. So, you know, one of the things that was interesting to me and coming from an education background, as well as teaching at many of these courses, is what is the impact of cadavec learning on patient outcomes? Because if this is the gold standard, I would have imagined that there was multiple data to support its utility, given the cost and the value of this that we believe it brings. Now, if this is the model of training, we know it's very, very expensive. We know it's not widely available. And we know that this type of model is extremely expensive. And that I refer to this as fractional experiences because nobody goes into a cadaver lab like I've shown you and does the entire procedure from end to end. They will do part of the procedure. And so this is our gold standard right now, but what is the evidence that this is the gold standard? This is perhaps the most comprehensive meta-analysis of comparing cadaver simulation for surgical training. 51 studies were evaluated over the last nearly 100 years. MERSCI is an educational index that's used to evaluate research done in education. What was observed in this was quite interesting. So this on the left is what's referred to as a Kirkpatrick scale for educational impact. 22 of these studies evaluated the evaluation of a reaction, which means the trainee went into and performed the cadaver and then actually reported afterwards that they felt confident they could do the surgery. Self-reported competency is what this is referred to. As you get higher, the research studies in this hierarchy actually are much better and perhaps gold standard. 5 studies evaluated these participants after doing a test. So you did a cadaver lab and then you scored high in a test. So verbal knowledge or didactic theory knowledge. 4 studies actually compared the cadaver to simulation. And interestingly, these studies were unequal in the sense that cadaver was dominant in one, simulation was dominant the other. And in 2 studies, they were actually identical in reporting outcomes in this particular group of studies. There was only one study that actually said that practicing on a cadaver actually has direct patient outcomes. And that was a study looking at ICU skills, specifically intubation and chest tube insertion. Although it wasn't brought in detail in this particular meta-analysis, I suspect the reason was because if you practice intubating on a cadaver and you break a tooth, you get that immediate feedback. Similarly, with putting a chest tube in, if you penetrate the lung or you go above or below the rib, that's something that you can evaluate objectively immediately. Now, as an educator, one of the things that became interesting to me is understanding how we learn. And so learning a little bit about the science of how we learn is actually in complete contradiction to how we learn in medicine, in this case, surgery. Edwin Locke's theory of motivation, in summary, basically says that we are inherently lazy as people. because this theory of motivation suggests that we will learn when we need to. So surgeons or trainees will not practice for a case, time permitting, a week, 10 days before, mostly because they don't have the time, but they're also not motivated inherently to practice or learn about something a week before they have to do a procedure. Now, unfortunately, that's also then supported by Ebbinghaus's theory of forgetting curve, which supports the idea that unless you apply a skill immediately after you learn it, you will forget the majority of that knowledge within 6 days, and it's shown here on the right. So if we're not motivated to do something right before or shortly thereafter, we're at risk of forgetting that knowledge shortly after that retention time. Now, the way to mitigate against this is to actually space out your learning. So if I am going to do something on the following Monday, I would practice the Monday, Wednesday, and Friday before. We know that this spacing effect allows you to retain knowledge beyond 60 days. The most effective model of learning actually has been championed by the late Anders Ericsson, who was a friend and mentor of mine who sadly passed away last year. He talks about how practice should not be mindless. You want to repeat, but it should be experiential and drive your decision making that you can learn from the data that you actually receive from your performance. Now, of course, if we break all this up and we look at what's happened in this ecosystem of surgery and we continue the same thing over and over again, we know that Einstein would say that this is somewhat insane. Now, I bring up this next slide to suggest 15 years. Every 15 years, there's a new innovation. And somebody was asking me today, well, what innovation happened 15 years ago? And that was the iPhone. The innovation that happened prior to that was the first cardiac surgery that actually happened in the United States, which was around the 1980s or 86 or so. Now, many of you may have heard of virtual reality. What is virtual reality? It refers to a computer-generated simulation where a person can actually interact with a three-dimensional artificial environment. Now, 4 years ago, when I started this company with my two co-founders, this was quite an elaborate setup where we had a high-powered computer. It was attached to multiple wires and base stations, which were actually fancy cameras to detect our position in space. Now, the technology on the hardware side has advanced so much that there's no laptop, there's no wires, and this device here, which is actually made by Facebook, weighs less than a pound. Now imagine in this headset, relies you be able to fix a fracture, practice a knee replacement, the fracture I showed you earlier. You learn how to do a novel technique like an anterior hip replacement. You can learn robotics, for example, we'll be interested to hear the talk later today. You can learn pediatric surgery, anatomy, and then of course you can learn from another mentor who may not be anywhere near you, perhaps in a different country or in a different part of the world altogether. So Precision OS, what we are is an advanced simulation company in virtual reality. And you know, one of the things that we've tried to champion here is that there is such an inherent power of VR that harnessing it correctly actually allows you to see some of the research. And I'll show you some of the data that we've been able to capture on this technology when built with this mentality. So here's a sample video, and this is available on our website as well, which sort of identifies and goes over the things that we just can't do. I'm just gonna make sure that volume is turned down a little bit here. But one of the ideas here is this idea of whole task training, where you can actually create an environment for a learner where they take the patient into consideration as well. You know, when you go to a cadaver lab or you operate in a simulator, what's missing is the actual patient. So here we can identify and actually place the learner into this entire environment where they can actually do things, deepen their understanding of the procedure while allowing them to make mistakes in a very safe and a risk-free environment. And here you're seeing where I can capture my mistakes and I can learn from them immediately. Here's something that's novel that we've built, which is an arthroscopy simulator. Historically, these exist in very capital intense simulators, which are not available in most part of the world because they're just not affordable, and allowing the user to go through, make error, and actually learn from that error in a very objective and quantifiable way that they can respond to, as per the discussion earlier by Anders Ericsson. And here is me just demonstrating doing a knee replacement and then cutting the tibia, or in this case the femur, and then evaluating my performance as I go through. Here I am learning a novel technique. So the anterior hip replacement is quite a new and novel procedure. Here I am making cuts on this bone. And this next part here you're gonna see is I'm actually teaching residents and fellows who are actually not even within my vicinity, but they have the hardware and the software to actually engage with me in a very collaborative learner and learnee way and mentor mentee way. And I can actually interact with them as I would if I was standing next to them across a cadaver or even in a patient situation. So what is the evidence behind this? So one of the things that all of us in healthcare really appreciate is high quality and independently evaluated research. So here's a study that was done by members of the Shoulder Elbow Society here in Canada at the University of Ottawa, as well as the Canadian Orthopedic Association. So what we looked at in this particular study was, our theory was, what is the skill and knowledge transfer of graduating surgeons using this method, which we refer to as deliberate practice-based immersive virtual reality, to learn both pathology recognition and to actually perform a complex but yet common procedural reconstruction. This was a multi-center study of graduating surgery residents, as mentioned by the Canadian Shoulder Elbow Society. These two groups were randomized to either precision OS software or actually watching a video of an expert surgeon performing this procedure available on a commonly used and accessible website of this procedure called an augmented base plate or a shoulder replacement. And this study was powered to show a difference in this particular model. So shown in a different way in this consort model, 18 senior or graduating residents randomized to virtual reality or performing a video. Both of them perform a knowledge test after this experience. Both of them do a confidence assessment, and then both of them then go to the cadaver lab where they're evaluated by blinded members of the Canadian Shoulder Elbow Society who have no idea what type of intervention they had. What was unique about this study is that the members of the Shoulder Elbow Society actually created, to simulate a real patient experience, a deformity in the socket of the shoulder. And I pardon the graphic nature of this for those of you not in healthcare. But I talked about earlier about learning on the normal. Now we're actually testing people in the abnormal, which suggests, could this have some translational property to an actual real patient? So after the cadaver was made abnormal by the members of the Shoulder Elbow Society, both groups then went to the lab, performed the procedure, and they were evaluated by the members of the society using these additional secondary outcomes, such as OSATs, global rating scale, evaluated the implant, and then of course a cost and a learning assessment was also done. What we found was very interesting, but not so much on the demographic side. There's a couple things I want to highlight here. There was no difference in demographics. Both groups actually reported attending multiple courses on this particular area of the body, which is shoulder. Now, RSA stands for reverse arthroplasty or shoulder replacement. When asked, these trainees actually reported that many of them performed 10 to 20 of these procedures on their own as the primary surgeon, which is quite a lot. Both groups felt that they learned something after watching a video or doing virtual reality. Both groups felt they were ready to operate on this particular cadaver, and both groups felt equally confident they could do the procedure in the cadaver. Now the results actually speak and report something else. The surgery time was equal when assessed from front to end for both groups. Both groups did equal number of steps from front to back. When we looked at the correct orientation of the augment or the implant, the VR group got it correctly, put it correctly in place 100% of the time. The video group put it in place correctly 22% of the time. When the members of the society checked the correct size for the defect, they used the correct implant for the defect. 100% of the VR group correctly identified this. 0% of the video group got this correct. When they looked at the orientation of the guide wire, the wire that goes in that basically determines where you're going to put your implant, 100% of the VR group got it correct. 0% of the video group got it correct. And of course, reaming the appropriate amount of bone, 88% of the VR group, and only 11% of the non-VR group got it correct. And of course, this was all statistically significant. When you break this down, the video group's performance in this particular procedure would have led to a catastrophic failure in these patients. The other thing that we can do in VR is we identify this idea called a precision score because we can quantify their performance. What we found was this was highly correlated to their technical assessment done by the members of the society, and furthermore, the implant orientation. So now we actually have the early findings of a predictive model or predictive score in VR, which can actually tell you how you're going to perform in the cadaver lab or perhaps a real clinical scenario. And of course, I won't get into the details of this, but we basically show that this is the virtual versus real world transfer effectiveness ratio is 0.79. You can actually make this equivalent in experience in VR to 51 cases in real life. And it is certainly cost effective to learn this way than it is to practice on a simulator and, of course, training on a patient in the operating room. So this is one of the first studies of its kind to show that we can actually perhaps reduce real-world training time in the virtual space, that understanding steps of a procedure can actually still lead to complications, and that confidence, as we all know, does not lead to competence. So then I'll move into the idea of teaching. So we talk about do one and teach one. And this is a really lovely picture. It's referred to as a school of Athens. Aristotle and Plato are there right in the middle. And what this simplifies is how people get together and learn and teach others very, very well and very, very effectively. And so this is a study that we just completed and it's currently under preparation, where we looked at the impact of kinesthetic learning. So actually doing the procedure and then identifying where the implant is in place. What we did in this scenario, we took 8 cadavers and randomized the cadavers to the novice and the expert group. The novice group actually got to put the implant in, and the experts or the teacher observed the novice watching them do the procedure. So now I'm creating this environment where we have a learner and a mentor in the operating room. What we asked both groups to do is to tell us where the implant was in the cadaver after they had either completed the procedure as a novice or as an expert who was watching the resident put the implant in. We compared that to a 3D reconstruction and then compared the groups to see what they actually found. Now, the findings were actually somewhat surprising to us. Both groups thought the implant was in the wrong place. So they thought it was inferiorly tilted, so tilted down, where it was actually superiorly tilted, which is actually the wrong position or an at-risk position for a patient. What was interesting is the novice group, i.e. the group that actually put the implant in, was much better at determining the implant location versus the experts. And the experts were actually worse at determining the position by almost 20 degrees. So if I put that into perspective for you, if I'm teaching my resident how to do a procedure and I'm guiding them on what to do, I could be 20 degrees off because I'm actually not doing the procedure, I'm watching them do the procedure. 50 million is the number of patients who have complications every year in healthcare. Now, I want to share the impact of this with one of our recent studies that just got accepted. It's an example, it's an unfortunate example, but it shows you the power and the absence of training that we have currently in our system. The x-ray on the left is a boy who's 15 years old, who presented to a surgeon who's been in practice for 25 years. This hip x-ray is actually, it's called a slipped epiphysis, but for simplicity, it's a fracture of the hip. The surgeon, after 2 surgeries, taking 200 x-rays during surgery and a significantly aesthetic time, put the screw in the wrong place. This is where the screw ended up, and this is where the screw should have been. This surgeon then transferred the patient to the children's hospital, where the trainee actually practiced in our system and actually did the case by himself on his own with a single surgery, 10 times less radiation and significantly less anesthetic time. So this is about one example of the impact that kinesthetic learning and practicing in this environment can actually have on direct patient outcomes. Now I'll close with my last 2 slides to say we're pretty humbled and honored to be part of this organization as well. Sign Fracture Care is a humanitarian organization that trains surgeons in low middle income countries. Their current model is to fly from Seattle to Africa to train these surgeons to how to do tibial and femoral nails, because the most common injury that happens there of the working class is they're struck by vehicles and they break a leg, and the historical management has been to put them in traction or have them lay in bed to fix those fractures. So this group goes there to teach them how to put nails and rods down those limbs so the patients can actually start walking. When someone can't walk after a leg fracture, their family goes into deeper poverty because the daily income for many of these is $2 a day. So if you can't work, their family goes into deeper poverty, which has an additional generational impact. So we're proud to report that we have created a virtual reality module for them so they can actually teach those surgeons in Africa from their home in Seattle, impacting more lives around those middle-income countries. So in summary, VR is an emerging technology and the days are extremely early. It's, however, making rapid advances. Now, is it possible that we can provide some form of hands-on experience that's actually based in the learning or the science of learning? where you can objectify your performance. It doesn't eliminate the idea of mentorship. In fact, it strengthens the need for it. But now I can learn from a surgeon who I may never have access to if I lived in a different part of the world. The ability for me to travel to, say, a place like Boston or Chicago is just not within my repertoire or my affordability. But now we can change that with a technology like this. Something like VR or this model may actually address some of the largest problems addressing our industry, like surgeon training, learning curves, peer-to-peer engagement, and of course, team-based training. And surgical education does, in my view, require a transformation. And the question that we're asking and continue to push the limits on is, can VR deliver that? And with that, I want to thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Danny. Thank you for that great talk. Our audience are really curious now, and they're asking questions. So if you want to look at the chat, I'm going to ask the first question from Dr. Divya Chenda. She asks, is this system more like also VR? Is it similar to that, or how is it different?
Yeah, so it's actually, it's different in the sense that we allow people to make mistakes in our system, where you can go in and have the freedom to make error. And so we champion that deliberate practice idea, which is actually technically very, very challenging to do. And so that's how our, that's our primary differentiator between what they do, which is quite valuable, and what we do. The philosophical approach to education that we have is very different.
Great. Thank you. The next question is from Dr. Alan Young. He asks, did the trainees spend the same amount of time in VR versus video? And did the voiceover or narration cover the same content?
Yeah, excellent question. So the VR group, historically, VR across different industries outside of healthcare has been shown to be much more rapid in providing education. So the amount of time that the VR group spent was actually 4 minutes per session. And the video group actually spent 40% more time watching the video, which was in the 16 to 18 minute range. And the narration was nearly the same in both the video as well as in VR.
Great. Thank you. Let's see. Next question from Dr. Divya Chander. Is the 50 million number, is it North America, Canada, or global?
That's a global number.
Okay. And with your system, does it provide haptic feedback during training?
Yes. So it's a good question. So the controllers that come with the VR system actually allow you to have some haptics. And the question that we're also asking is, how much haptics is necessary? So I'm giving a talk in a few weeks at the Stanford Mixed Media about this particular topic. So when we look at orthopedics is unique that when you drill or saw through bone, the sound changes. The other thing that happens is the vibration in your drill or saw also changes. So you can emulate a virtual portion of that in our system. And the question, there is no such thing as normal haptics when you drill and to perform surgery, because you may have a patient who's 90, you may have a patient who's 19, and the bone is going to be different, and therefore the haptics are different. But synesthesia is the idea of using one or two senses to substitute for the other. So the question is, how much haptics do you really need, and is what we can deliver in VR enough, which I believe it is, to allow skill transfer?
Right. Another question from Usman. Can your system extend to real-time mentoring?
Yes, so that's the video that I was showing. When you say real-time, so real-time in the virtual space, not with a patient. So that video, towards the end of the video where you actually see myself and multiple trainees in the virtual space, that's happening in real-time, and I'm talking to them in real-time around this virtual patient.
Okay, Lawrence asks, one of the confounders for VR using Oculus is the sensory mismatch of visual, vestibular, proprioceptive input, and some of the users become nauseous. Are you having this difficulty, or have you seen this problem?
It's an excellent question. So one of the things with Quest and, you know, what we're doing right now and watching a TV is related to frames per second. So TV typically has a frames per second of around 20. VR historically had frames per second around 40, where you would move and the environment would not move. And that's what impacted the vestibular system to make people nauseated. With the Oculus Quest and systems such as this, we can actually get up to 60 or 70 frames per second, which effectively makes that motion one-to-one, eliminating this particular problem, which was seen historically. It's an excellent question. In the last 4 years, I have not seen it. Perhaps one or two people, but.
Good, good. Dr. David Duke asks, can this be used to teach patients, for example, how to give insulin injections or self-catheterization or physical therapy? Physical therapy, let's hold off that question because we have that solution here. But what do you think about patients using VR?
You know, I think that, so Facebook's agenda is to have everybody have a headset over time. And I think that teaching people tasks, so fitness, for example, is a very common use case for virtual reality right now. So I don't see why this wouldn't be out of the ordinary to teach people to be able to do things like this, such as injection of insulin and self-catheterization. It's going to require some regulatory hurdles to get over, I'm sure, but I would suspect that that would be not a far reach in the next 3 to 5 years.
Right. And Dr. Edmundo asks, do you have a website? Please type it
yes,
into the
I sure
chat
will, yes.
Box.
I'll put my website as well as my LinkedIn page on the chat. Thank you for everybody's questions.
Martina asks, how far away are we from remote surgeries?
So when they say, so do using virtual reality to perform surgery? So there's one company that I know that is really trying to champion this called Vicarious Surgical, and they're using VR to actually train and perform virtual surgery with a robot. And if that's the question, I would certainly refer to that company as a good model for where that exists.
So is that in practice or is that still in research mode?
That's still in research. Well, actually they are in practice now.
Oh,
yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Great. Wipula Taylor asks, says, great presentation. What was one big hurdle you saw in adopting this?
You know, I think those hurdles continue. And I think that one of the things with VR is I've shown you a very nice video on this Zoom call, but the real impact of it really can't be felt unless you put the headset on. And you can actually see how immersive and what's referred to as embodied learning and how impactful that can be. And that is probably the biggest challenge, is explaining it to people without actually having them have a headset and put the headset on and go through the actual procedure to see how impactful it could be.
Ripple also has another question about therapeutic interventions. Yes, Ripple, we are right here in Torque 3 headquarters, the workshop where, you know, we are building something very unique for a therapeutic intervention. So hold off on that question. So where are you now? Is there a free trial version to download? Sam Gonzalez asks.
Yeah, Sam, feel free to email me and we can talk through how that works.